In 1964, a paleontologist named John Ostrom dug up some fascinating fossils from the mudstone of Montana. The fossils were of a slim, sleek dinosaur with sharp curved claws on its feet and a long tail supported by tendons that allowed it to work as a rudder. These fossils belonged to one of the most important discoveries that lead to a better understanding of the dinosaurs and how they behaved. From the evidence, Ostrom could tell this new dinosaur was an active, agile predator. But that was totally at odds with the popular interpretations of dinosaurs at the time, which was that they were all slow, dumb, lumbering beasts. This revolutionary discovery was given the name Deinonychus, or Terrible Claw. Ostrom's description of it set the stage for what's known today as the Dinosaur Renaissance, a total rethinking of what we thought we knew about dinosaurs. Deinonychus had an important role to play in the discovery of the true blood type of dinosaurs. They helped scientists gravely because of the traces of feathers found on the fossils. Like birds, feathered animals are warm-blooded, suggesting a bird-like behavior as well. Deinonychus was one of the reasons for the theory that dinosaurs evolved into birds. But today, this dinosaur is rarely known and is overlooked. Deinonychus was the base figure for Jurassic Park's Velociraptor, and Michael Crichton actually studied Deinonychus, but named the dinosaurs Velociraptors because it sounded cooler. Deinonychus is actually a very close cousin of the Velociraptor, but almost three times larger in size. Deinonychus's agile, sleek body shape inspired the theory that dinosaurs were actually active, fast-moving creatures, rather than as previously thought. Because of the amazing discovery of Deinonychus, the way we looked at dinosaurs changed forever. This fossil had a huge role in the history of paleontology. Deinonychus is found to be one of the smartest dromaeosaurs, which are commonly called raptors, and of any dinosaur. They were fast, agile, and swift. What gave them their name was the huge sickle-like ripping claw on each of its first toes that stood upright. Scientists originally thought the claw was used to rip prey, but newer evidence shows the claw was rather used to pin down prey to feed or deliver a bite. A few fossils of recently dead Deinonychus were found next to a giant herbivorous dinosaur, which was almost 10 times larger and heavier than Deinonychus, leading us to believe they were coordinative pack hunters. This amazing dinosaur changed the view of dinosaurs forever. Without it, we would still be thinking as we did earlier. And one of the key questions scientists revisited was that if dinosaurs were cold-blooded or warm-blooded. For decades, scientists have been studying this question, trying to solve it, attacking it from every angle. And so far, the answer seems to be that they were both warm-blooded and cold-blooded. But also neither? The more studies scientists did after the discovery of Deinonychus with the help of the features and feathers, they couldn't come up with an explanation to if dinosaurs were warm-blooded or cold-blooded. But we found traces of them being both. Seeming as some dinosaurs were so active, they sometimes ran a bit warm, even though they were otherwise cold-blooded. We know that this is at least possible because that's how some fish live, like modern tunas and landmid sharks. These animals use a sophisticated network of blood vessels to keep the heat generated from their working muscles inside their bodies instead of losing it to the cold ocean waters around them. So even though most animals today are one or the other, dinosaurs were probably somewhere in between. Some dinosaurs were more ectothermic, while the others endothermic. Animals like this, that control their body temperature in a variety of ways, are known as mesothermic, and today they are pretty rare. Of course, we've only been talking about the extinct dinosaurs. What complicated this picture even more is that avian dinosaurs, aka birds, are all warm-blooded. So how did that switch happen? How did a group of animals just completely reorganize their physiology to go from mesothermic to endothermic? Modern birds can tell us some interesting things about the origins of endothermic. Think of a baby bird. When it hatches, it's naked and depends on its parents for warmth. It's basically a little ectotherm. But as they develop, their tissues start producing more energy through the mitochondria in their cells. As a result, the mitochondria gave off more heat. It becomes an endotherm. Well, we don't really understand what causes the mitochondria to kick into high gear like this, but we think this will one day tell us a lot about what mechanisms could be at play in the evolution of endothermy. We do at least have a sense of when endothermy evolved in birds. The fossil record shows that, in the mid-Cretaceous period, birds had respiratory turbulence, as you'll expect an animal with a very high metabolism would need for flight. And by the late Cretaceous, birds were fully endothermic. And not a moment too soon. Stop me if you've heard this before, but 66 million years ago, a combination of volcanic activity and a massive asteroid impact set off a global catastrophe of dust, acid rain, and cold. and at least 75% of all species on Earth vanished, including all the non-avian dinosaurs. But the ancestors of the modern birds survived. Warm-blooded animals could survive even if the climate took a turn for the worse. But even though they were endotherms, they needed much smaller amounts and different kinds of food than the huge dinosaurs did. Out of the ashes of the extinction event, the avian dinosaurs rose and filled most of the niche vacant from their more reptilian cousins. So, sometimes, unearthing a revolutionary fossil like Deinonychus solves a mystery. But more often than not, it brings up more questions. But the questions themselves are incredibly valuable because they remind us that there's a lot more to these terrible lizards than we once thought. Hey guys! Thank you for watching this video. Just wanted to say, we're working on a new video right now, and we'll hope to upload every week from now. Our next video will be the second top recommended video on our community, the topic, The Unseen Dinosaur Killer, then we'll go on to When Dinosaurs Were Cold-Blooded. Also stay tuned for our new, PBN Dinosaur Science, series coming out soon.